On behalf of Dr. Lawrence B. Alexander, Chancellor of the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the 2016 Lyceum program. Annually, the Lyceum Committee develops a cultural and entertaining program to meet the varying needs and interests of students. While the Lyceum program is primarily designed for the university students, the program is open to the Pine Bluff community. The Lyceum Committee is composed of UAPB students, faculty, and staff. This year, the students took center stage and requested a presenter who would address issues relevant to the African American community, including the Black Lives Matter campaign. When UAPB contacted the Institute on Race and Ethnicity at the University of Arkansas at Little Rock, today's presenter was immediately and highly recommended. I believe everyone in the audience today will be impacted by her research project and presentation. But first, it gives me great pleasure to introduce the 86th Miss University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, Miss Brianna Allen, who brings today's greeting.
Ella Baker once said, "Give light and people will find the way." Good morning. On behalf of Chancellor Lawrence B. Alexander, it is my distinct pleasure to bring you warm greetings here at the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. UAPB's Lyceum Committee has brought outstanding presenters and panelists to campus who has enhanced student life and provided opportunities and ideas that have influenced career paths for future graduates. As Miss University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, I have been honored to represent UAPB with a focus on providing light with various programs, and it is my most to hope to leave a legacy. Every student has the opportunity to serve not only UAPB, but also to the greater Pine Bluff community. With a commitment to leave an impacting legacy, as I greet you this morning and you listen to the outstanding presenter on program, I hope you will be inspired to ask yourself, what legacy will I leave? Greetings and welcome to the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. Thank you.
Next, the SGA Vice President and the Regional Oratorical Contest winner for the Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated, Mr. Alexander Watkins, will introduce our Lyceum presenter. Mr. Watkins.
I am honored to be able to introduce UAPB's 2016 Lyceum presenter, Dr. Adjoa A. Aiyetoro, who is a professor of law with the William H. Bowen School of Law at the University of Arkansas at Little Rock. Dr. Aiyetoro joined the faculty in 2004. Professor Aiyetoro graduated cum laude from St. Louis University School of Law, where she was inducted into the Jesuit Honor Society, Alpha Sigma Nu. Before joining the Bowen School of Law, she had a career as a human rights attorney. Professor Aiyetoro began her legal career as a staff attorney with the United States Department of Justice, Civil Rights Division, Special Litigation Section, where she litigated cases involving the rights of the institutionalized and developed an expertise in prisoner rights. She joined the ACLU National Prison Project in 1981, where she remained until 1992. Since 1992, she has served as the executive director of the National Conference of Black Lawyers, the director of administration for the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation, a consultant to the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law, and the chief legal consultant for the National Coalition of Blacks for Reparations in America. Professor Aiyetoro was an adjunct professor with the American University, Washington College of Law from 1997 through 2003. A visiting scholar with the University of California at Santa Barbara Center for Black Studies during the spring of 2003, and a visiting professor at West Virginia College of Law during the fall of 2004. Professor Aiyetoro has extensive experience working domestically and internationally to obtain remedies for historical and present-day wrongs to people of color, women, and other oppressed groups. She represented the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom at the 2000-2001 Conference Against Racism, including attending all the preparatory meetings and serving as a leader of the African and African Descendant Caucus. In 1995, Dr. Aiyetoro coordinated the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights under Law's delegation to the United Nations Conference on Women in Beijing. And she also represented the organization at the 2000 Beijing Plus Five. Professor Aiyetoro is a prolific writer with numerous publications and recently completed a 3-year project titled Racial Disparities in the Arkansas Criminal Justice System. Her presentation today will include her findings from this research project as she addresses today's theme, Do Black Lives Matter? Please join me in showing our Golden Lion appreciation to today's Lyceum presenter, Dr. Adjoa A. Aiyetoro.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you first to Ms. Georgette Wiley, you got a great one here with Ms. Wiley, because she stays after you, man. She does not let you slide. So I want to thank you very much for all the work that you did and everyone that worked with you did. I want to thank this young man, this budding to-be lawyer, Mr. Alexander. I've claimed it now. He's got to be a lawyer, right? I claimed it. And I didn't know you were in my father's fraternity. Dad, it was. He's deceased now, an Alpha. So I want to thank you very much for that very gracious introduction. I initially was going to speak just on the study that we did, and then Ms. Wiley informed me that many of the students were really interested in and concerned about and maybe even involved in the Black Lives Matter movement. And I told her that I felt that my topic, really, of the research fits right in with the issue around Black Lives Matter. So I want to first start, because I think sometimes because many times we get the soundbite, Black Lives Matter, we don't really get what the Black Lives Matter movement really is about. We think it's about, as it did start out of the murder of Trayvon Martin and the acquittal of his murderer, Zimmerman. I think a lot of people, I have to say, me included, until I studied some and in fact talked to some people involved in it, thought it was really just about dealing with police violence against blacks, and most particularly black men. But it's not. It is a broad movement about Black Lives Matter. And so what I want to do, I usually don't read unless I got just very, very, very little time, and I know I can wander. So, and I don't know who's the timekeeper, but somebody needs to tell me, good, you just give me a 1 minute, 2 minute, you know, whatever. But I want to read a little bit because I think it's important to understand what they're about. And I think if we really understand what they're about, it's going to challenge many of us who think only some black lives matter. Those some black lives who are, you know, made out of the same cloth that maybe I'm made out of. I can't speak to everybody in here what you're made out of. I know my parents, and I know I was raised black middle class. My father was a postal worker. My mother was a school teacher. In the black community, they're strong. Middle class, you know. May not be in the white community, but in the black community, that's strong middle class. And I know that for me, I was raised a Christian. I was raised in the CME church. In fact, my father graduated from Lane College Jackson, Tennessee. And so for me, if we look at that narrative, we think sometimes Black Lives Matter to black middle class or striving middle class people. And we forget about that Black Lives Matter is broader than that, right? We forget that Black Lives Matter is that guy standing on the corner or that woman standing on the corner, because, you know, somehow we think, you know, many times we only pay attention to the black males, but black women and men standing on the corner with the wine bottle in their hand, right? Or shooting up drugs or smoking marijuana or sniffing coke, right, or crack. We don't think those lives matter. You know, we think they're throwing their life away. Well, oh my God. And many times we, and I'm saying we, even though I don't personally view it this way, but I'm joining in with much of our values that somehow we say, oh, we turn our nose up. And not just black people, white people, Latino people, I'm not just talking about we black people, but many times we turn away from, right? We turn away from that gay black person, that transgender black person. We turn away from them. Black lives don't matter when it comes to them many times. So we think Black Lives Matter really is about the Trayvon Martin, that young black male who was struck down unfairly so and inhumanely so by a white slash, you know, he owned his Latino heritage only when, you know, people tried and said, well, this is racist. Oh, no, I'm not racist. You know, my father's Hispanic. I'm Hispanic, right? So that Michael Brown, the man in gray in, I think, Baltimore, and, you know, the man in New York. And so that's when we say Black Lives Matter, because we view these as innocent, right? As innocent black men who may not be, you know, the president of a university or, you know, some big shot, but just innocent black men, right? So we think Black Lives Matter is about their lives. It's about the lives of those young men that are in the audience, Mr. Alexander and others that are here. That's who we think Black Lives Matter. But Black Lives Matter movement is a broad movement. It's about all black lives. It's about all black lives. And it's the base of it is really the base of our research, right? The base of it is the historic since slavery of the creation of this somehow myth that in some ways, you know, and I'm talking to some teachers so I know you all understand, becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, right? This view that black people are less than. This view that we are inferior, this created narrative that says, you know, black men are violent, black men are thieves, black women are whores, you know, all of this stereotype, this created image. And it was created for one purpose. And some of you know the purpose, but I'm gonna say it out loud. It's created to create and maintain white supremacy. That's why it was created. It wasn't just, bam, you know, we got these, we captured these savages in Africa and put them on these ships to save their lives. Well, why would you put them on a ship and stack them like sardines, right? Why would you pay people to go into the villages to steal people who had, neither one knew what was going on, right? It was like, some people say, well, black people support Africans, supported slavery. Well, they had no clue. They had no clue. Now, does that mean they were right to take money from the white guy, to go in and steal some black people? No, but they had no clue what they were selling our ancestors into. They had no clue the barbarity of U.S. enslavement. No clue. People say, oh, there was slavery all over, but not this slavery, not chattel slavery, not where you lost the right to say your name, not where you lost the right to speak your language, not where you lost the right to have and maintain and create family. So, Black Lives Matter is embracing a historic narrative in the present day. It is saying that black lives continue to be devalued, that's a nice word, in the goal of maintaining white supremacy. That black lives across the board, not simply those innocent black men, innocent outwardly, we know, right? Not just them, but black lives, all black lives, all black lives. So it challenges us when we actually study the movement to challenge us to drop our own stereotype. Those of us who are black and those of us who are white, who have bought that, we are really for equality, right? We really disavow discrimination. We think the police should stop shooting down innocent black men. But what about the non-innocent black men? What about the non-innocent black woman? We don't embrace that. So for me, the research that we've done, that we completed late last summer, and the reports were issued, released at our conference in August of 2015, is a demonstration of the continuing bias against non-innocent blacks. I'm not here to say that those 800 and so men and women, they gave us permission to look at their records. I'm not here trying to sell a line of they are innocent. They did, most of them, probably 99% of them, right? I used to do prisoner rights work. And people used to always prisoners always say they're innocent. That's not true. I did prisoner rights work all over the country. And most prisoners told me they did what they did. So the question isn't about innocence if we really are concerned about Black Lives Matter. The question is about how do we treat justly all lives? How do we treat justly all lives regardless of the color of the skin? And I say that because I teach critical race theory. And Du Bois said, many of you know this statement, Du Bois said it's the question for the 20th century is what? The question of the color line. This is a smart man. He knew the term race. This was not somebody that the word race was introduced after he was long gone, right? He knew the word race. He was purposeful. The question for the 20th century is the question for the color line. Why? Because it is by our color that we are judged. It's by our color. Black man walking down the street that looks like Mr. Alexander as compared to black man walking down the street. I don't know. I can't point out anybody, but this guy here, he could be black. Uh-oh, be careful. Right? But he is not suspect. Not because of some genealogical test, which again, I'm gonna probably, tell you, there is really no genealogical test for race, okay? Let's just be clear. But, they tell it to you, right? But not by any way of saying, let's go back into the heritage and see whether or not anyone that we call black is in his line. We automatically know that people who we call black are in Mr. Alexander's line. Okay? So we are judged by our color, not by some test of race. We're judged by our color. How many black people did, and maybe some continue, those who we can check, know their family heritage, passed? There's a professor who, is really a friend of mine, and she's a professor at UCLA, and she wrote an article called Whiteness as Property, Cheryl Harris. And what she talked about is how her grandmother passed in Chicago. Her grandmother passed in the white community. She didn't pass in the black community. Some people pass and they gone. You look up and Sally Sue is gone. And if you see Sally Sue on the street, you better not speak to Sally Sue. other than in a way that keeps her blackness concealed. But how Cheryl Harris's grandmother passed, she got on the bus in the black community. All the black folks got off when they were going into white homes to work. She stayed on the bus and went downtown Chicago, where she had a job as a sales clerk in a department store. Now, in my lifetime, I ain't gonna tell you how old I am, but in my lifetime, when I was young, black people didn't work in these big name department stores. This might be new to some of you young people. They didn't. If they worked there, they were cleaning people. They were not salespeople. But she had to stand around and listen to the outrageous racist conversation of her colleagues, and she couldn't speak up because right away they wouldn't know. You know, because that was back then that even if you disagreed with them and you were white, you didn't say anything. Right? So the issue is really to steal from, borrow from, and I'm not plagiarizing because I put the tag on WEDB Du Bois, the issue today continues to be the color line. And the problem with that is it's used against us and not for us, much like it has been since enslavement, right? So the problem is we get treated differently, worse than, in so many ways, even today. How many of you who are black or white and have witnessed it, those whites have witnessed it, how many of you have been standing at the grocery counter and you know I was there first, been there, standing there, got the ticket if they still got have those pulled numbers down, if there was one, been there. You walk up and the clerk turns to you and says, may I help you? That's happened to me recently. That's not old, okay? That's a continuation of the bias against color. And many times, it's either unconscious or as my friend, colleague, who is now the first African-American woman dean at FAMU's law school says, subconscious. She says, it gives too much to say unconscious. We're buying this unconscious racism in order to make white people feel better. Sometimes it's not even unconscious or subconscious, but let's say it could be subconscious. That you're acting automatically. That clerk is acting automatically and acting from stereotype because white lives are more valued. So of course, white customers are more valued. Subconsciously or unconsciously, maybe still a few consciously. You know, how many of you have experienced what people call microaggressions? Just small things that you say, well, why did they say that to me? What? You know, I just put my cat down yesterday, so I hope I don't cry. But I took my cat to the hospital on Saturday. Me, my cat, and this carrier, right, that I had her in. This young white woman, I was at the counter. I put my cat down on the floor at the chair, went to the counter to sign her in at this emergency hospital. And I heard her cat kind of, you know, sounding terrible, you know, like she was attacking somebody. It was really her, but I won't say it. And then I sat down. Now, my carrier, I ain't trying to play no class game, but I'm gonna play this class game. It's top of the line Sherpa, right? Had it for as long as I've had my cat and was traveling with her. Top of the line. It's like Oprah Winfrey going in somewhere, you know what I'm saying? And then you get treated like, well, what brought that on? This did, you know? Top of the line Sherpa, you know? Trimmed and leather, really top of the line. I sit down, and this white woman, young white woman, probably, you know, I don't know how old, but she couldn't have been over 30, right? 35 maybe. But she says, not directly to me, she says to the couple sitting beside me, the man looked like he may have Latina blood, I don't know. And the woman looked like she was white, I don't know. We really don't know. I want y'all to challenge your own perceptions, right? And she says, she don't like that thing. She ain't even seen my cat. She's pointing to my Sherpa, right? Well, why would you say that? What is it about a cat you can't even see in a green bag, Sherpa bag? It was directed at me. It wasn't directed at my cat. It had to be. You didn't see my cat. That thing. I said, she's a cat. Well, I didn't know. What is that but race? Now, you all can be nice. Just like we've all, you know, sometimes we're too nice, right? We don't want to call it race. NPR today, and then I'm going to get to my study. This is very interesting. The question about Trump and Cruz and the elections, right? A caller calls in, and now it's getting so that sometimes you can't tell, but a lot of times you can tell whether that voice is a black voice or a white voice. It's getting different now because we so-called integrated, right? But this clearly, to me, sounded like a white male voice, okay? Again, I'm assuming. He raises the point that what people really, the press really isn't dealing with, is Trump is getting support because he is raising issues of racism that whites can now gather around. I don't mean all of his supporters are white. A handful might be black or Latino or whatever. But he was making a point that I bet you many of you in this audience have made, right? I know I have. Why would you rally to this man who can't say anything positive about blacks or Latinos, in fact, or Muslims, you know, in fact, anyone that is considered to be either a person of color or in a religion of persons of color. You know, you can be a white Muslim, but he's really identifying with those who are in countries of color. The response of the person on the panel that Diane Rehm had was, well, no, I'm not sure. I think it's really about immigration. And really, I think what people are doing is they're just so opposed to the traditional that they're just going to Trump because Trump is not for the traditional. This is a reporter. This is a so-called intelligent person. First of all, if you're concerned about immigration, who are you concerned about? You're not concerned about European, white Europeans coming into this country. Come on. The question of immigration is a question of race and ethnicity. He raises that. But what happens is we avoid it. And I say we because many of us avoid it. Many of you in this audience probably don't want to talk about race, not especially in a forum where you don't know if you're in the majority, right? You know, we'll speak up if we would our buds, right? You know, people, yeah, man, the police did this, Trump that. But if we're in kind of mixed company, and especially if that mixed company might be more powerful, some of them may be more powerful than us, do we speak up?
No.
But we have to. I tell my students, if we're going to change the society, you got to get courage. You have to have courage. All of us, you have to have it. So our study, our study looked at racial disparities in the Arkansas, I call it punishment system. I call them all punishment systems. I call them punishment systems because they don't do justice. That might be somebody's goal that has created it, but it actually is, I tell my students, a legal fiction. It's a fiction. The criminal justice system is a fiction in this country. I can speak a little bit about some others, but really not with knowledge. It's a fiction. It doesn't do justice. It's not about fairness. It's not about equality. Stop drinking the juice. Some of you have been drinking it, I know. Don't stop drinking the juice. Stop. Why do you think we have such disparity? Why do you, even being conservative, why do you think 42-45% of the people locked up in this country, in prison, in this country, are black? Do you think 40-some percent of everybody that somehow comes into the criminal punishment system have such an egregious background and record that they are judged more harshly than whites who come into that system? Why do you think when I was working in D.C. and the data for Maryland, and it's still egregious, but I don't have the current, so y'all have to excuse me, but the data for Maryland were that 50% of those convicted of felonies were white and 50% were black, maybe a little small percentage of other, but not them, right? Not much people. But 75% of those incarcerated were black. Why? That's not justice. So our study said, let's look at the racial disparities in Arkansas's punishment system. Now, I had these big ideas that we could look at homicide and drugs and burglary. It took us 3 years to finish homicides. I'm so tired. Somebody else gonna have to do the other crimes, okay? We looked at homicide, and we looked at homicide where you had a sentence of life, life without parole, or death. We didn't look at all homicides because that would have taken us into manslaughter and those kind of things. And luckily, some little bird whispered in my ear, or spirit told me in my heart, you ain't no way you gonna do all this homicides, right? I didn't know that they were also saying there was no way I was gonna be able to move to other crimes, okay? There were 1,100 men and women, about maybe 11-something, that were, at the time we started our study in 2012, were locked up in Arkansas punishment system prisons for homicide with either life, life without parole, or death. So it was decided that we really, even though that we could have gotten permission, and we did get permission from the Arkansas Department of Corrections, that's another fiction, okay, but we'll keep, we'll be here all day if we talk about the fictions in our so-called justice system. But the Arkansas Department of Corrections, at that time it was Ray Hobbs, who was the head. I happen to know him. He was very accommodating. He's very concerned. He's no longer there, but he was very concerned about these issues of disparity. However, his deputy said, but let's make sure we cross all our T's and dot all our I's. So we want you to create a consent form, and we'll send it out to all the prisoners that fit the category and see what you get. They were shocked. We got 800 and some prisoners to say, yeah, we signed it, quick, hurry. White and black, right? Fine, sure, uh-huh. They said that, they were negatively shocked. They said that was a surprisingly large number. We actually finished 536 records. Now, I don't know how many of you all have that doctorate or in statistics or math or whatever. I'm not just talking about grown folk, people got hair like me. I'm talking about how many of you all know statistics. That's a very large sample. We cannot really be challenged on the size of the sample, okay? That's a very large sample. If you compare it to the numbers in the prison, it's about half of the 1,100, right? About half. We had, okay? That's a huge sample. Most researchers don't get that large a sample, right? So we began our study, and we did, one of our researchers developed a code book. We all sat around and said, what do we think the factors are that should be in our code book? We had 75 factors from things like age. We didn't code name, we only coded numbers. So we don't have a record of the names other than on our informed consent sheet, a consent form. So we did name and race, not names, number and race and age and where they were from, where they were arrested, who arrested them. I mean, what kind of homicide was it? All of that, who was, the race of the victim, all of those things. We had 75 factors. Our study showed that Not by chance, and those of you who may know research knows there's correlation, there's coincidence, and then there is correlation, coincidence, and cause. So we can't say race caused it, right? But we also can say it did not happen by chance, because all of our findings were in the top for researchers. I'm not a researcher. I mean, I'm not even, I told the gentleman, said, well, do you have your PowerPoint? I said, I'm old school, you know? But it was like 99%, you know, 0.1, 0.2, right? In terms of significance. That means it didn't happen by chance. It means that the 42% of those locked up, 43% of those locked up in Arkansas's prisons who are black aren't there by chance. That the difference, the racial disparity is not by chance. That's what I'm talking about. They aren't there by chance either, because most of them did something, right? But that the disparity is not by chance, that race is a significant factor, significant, for those of you who aren't researchers, and I'm not one other than the research I've done, the work we did here, but I do mainly scholarly research. You know, that's the, I don't do mainly empirical research. This was empirical research, okay? It's not by chance. It's not by chance. When we look at education, it's not by chance that similarly educated blacks and whites, but blacks more often, significantly so, got a higher punishment for the same crime. It's not by chance. And I'm going to read you, because I don't want to, you know, belabor this, because it just makes me mad. I don't know about y'all, but it makes me mad. And so we have to do something about it, which I'll tell you a little bit about next. Blacks were more likely, this is key finding number one, blacks were more likely to receive capital murder for charges than were whites. Similarly situated folk, that's the terminology. This is not looking at a white person that, oh, oops, sorry, you know, the gun misfired and somebody's dead. Similar facts, similar. Blacks were more likely to receive capital punishment, capital murder charges, than whites. Key finding number two, blacks were more likely to receive more severe punishments than whites, especially the death penalty, okay? And then key finding number three, if I can get to that. Regardless of the convicted charge, blacks were more likely to receive more severe punishment than whites. Across the board, okay? Across the board. And this was what the data we collected from the records that we got permission to see. So that doesn't mean we excuse, and I want to be real clear, that doesn't mean that we excuse blacks who commit crime. That means that if we are concerned about Black Lives Matter, that we extend that movement in reality to saying to our prosecutors, to saying to people like y'all who are going to be jurors, some of you, to saying to judges, that we've got to address this unconscious, subconscious, maybe a little bit of conscious, prejudice in our system. That we've got to train jurors and judges and prosecutors about bias, that they may not be actively engaged, and most aren't. I don't want to be tongue-in-cheek with this. Most aren't consciously looking at that black male or that black woman and that white male and that white woman, saying the blacks, even though the crime is very similar and their background is very similar, most of the ones who were convicted of homicide, that was their first crime. So this is not, we're not talking about the lifelong criminal. Not that there weren't some that didn't have, you know, some stuff before. I'm not saying that. I'm saying most, I didn't bring that sheet, but most were first time. So we have to train, first of all, ourselves. It's easy to talk to someone else. Black Lives Matter means you have to first practice it. You can't preach it to me if you don't believe it. If you don't believe that that family in that poverty-stricken neighborhood where the man may or may not be there, and that's another fiction that we'll talk about at another time, but may or may not be there, or that they were very poor, may or may not be working, maybe on welfare, maybe in public housing. You cannot say Black Lives Matter if their life doesn't matter. You can't say that. You can't say that Black Lives Matter if you, and I know I'm gonna get some of y'all, I know, just don't scream out. But if you are, if have a black gay or black transgendered person that you are judging, Black Lives Matter. You may not like it. My mom and dad didn't like a lot of stuff I did, but they always were there to support me. Always. I had good parents. And I tell you, I tested them. I sure did. I am not here to tell you that I'm some sweet, innocent, always did the right thing kind of child and grown person. But they always loved me. They always supported me. I remember I was out on the street corner, I was born and raised in St. Louis, Missouri, Natural Bridge and King's Highway. Got off the bus because there was gonna be a fight and I wanted to watch it. My stop was one block down. I got off the bus. Now, first of all, my parents told me, and I was in high school, so I had very strict and very, my parents told me, you get off the bus at the stop, right? How many of y'all tell your child that? Get off the bus at the stop, right? And you walk this way. You know, you couldn't deviate too much. I can see a sister right there saying, yeah, I tell my child that. You were probably told that too. But I got off the bus because they were getting ready to tear into this child. Now, why? You know, you ask yourself now, why? I should have been on, if anybody's side, her side. And since I was what we used to call a chicken, I shouldn't have been on anybody's side. I should have stayed on the bus, gotten off at my stop. I got off, watched the fight. Then when it was time, I thought, well, it's time I better get home because, you know, also we were timed, right? You know, you had, you know, they knew how long it was going to take you to get home. Got home, I was fine. I, of course, didn't say anything to my parents about getting off the bus, watching a fight. Doorbell rings. Who's at the door but the police? The child that got beat up put my name in it. I guess she is mad because I was watching and didn't defend her. I have no clue. My daddy had to take off work the next day to go down to the juvenile whatever court or whatever, and we go into this room, and the people who were in it were there at the table, right? They looked and said, why are you here? I was so thankful. But I was still in trouble, right? I was in trouble because I got off the bus. So what I'm saying is, this is this black middle class child of a school teacher and a postal clerk. It really messed up. I mean, it wasn't major in the long haul, but it was major in the short haul for my parents, right? So how many, you know what they say in the Bible? I'm going to quote the Bible to y'all because I see some of y'all like the Bible. He who is without sin cast the first stone. You got to remember that when you're looking at those boys and girls and men and women who you're judging, whose back, you're turning your back on them. No, you may may not be a drunk standing on the corner. Well, you don't really know if he's a drunk or not. You just know he's sitting on the corner drinking, because that's a medical diagnosis for some of you who didn't know that. But why? So if Black Lives Matter, we have to be concerned about these men who are in prison, serving life, life with, and women, there were women in our group too, serving life and life without parole and on capital punishment. Only men are on capital, on death row in Arkansas. We have to be concerned about their lives. We have to be concerned that they were treated unjustly when they were treated more harshly. We have to be concerned with their lives and the lives of their families. And when we go to a lesser, which I don't have data on, lesser crimes, do you know that people who have felonies, their families can be thrown out of public housing if they come back to stay with them? Do you know, and there's this guy, younger people may know of him, some older people, I just learned about him from the Oprah Winfrey Soul, Super Soul Sunday, called Shaka Sangor. He spent 19 years in prison for a murder that he committed, right, in California, I believe. So what he is doing is he's going all over the country and he's talking about what we talk about some in our study report, redemption. When we throw people in prison, regardless of race, for life and life without parole, and God knows, death penalty, we have said that their lives have no and will not ever have any value. We have denied a principle I know of Christianity because I was raised a Christian. I ain't gonna tell you what I practice, no, but I was raised a Christian by a very Christian family. Redemption is the keynote of Christianity. We just passed Easter. Some of y'all were in church. And you know what Christ said to the robber, I think it was a robber, on the cross. Your sins have been forgiven. How do we throw not only black lives, but white lives and Latino lives away? These people, many of them, and we know that the age of most criminal behavior is between 17 and at the most 30, right? Most criminal behavior, right? That is the age, those of you scientists in here, I'm touching all of you, right? The scientists know, and we've got studies that show the brain, the portion of the brain that controls impulse is not fully developed until 25. How do we deny science? How do we look at a young person, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, you know, and the younger, you know, not because I'll be 70 on Saturday or Friday. How many, you know, gets younger, right? And older, somebody says 80, I'm like, oh, that's not too old. You know, oh, you know, it's like Maya Angelou said when she was asked by Oprah Winfrey, you enjoyed your 60s, you enjoyed your 70s, what do you think about your 80s? She says, the 80s are hot. If you can get there, do. But the point is, how do we deny that there can be change? How do we deny that that soul is lost? Even when they've committed the most egregious crime you can think of. Brian Stevenson out of Alabama, Harvard graduate, started a Southern, I forget the name of it, wrote a book, Just Mercy. You need to get it if you're concerned about this topic. How many of you are judged by the worst act you've committed? That's what we do in our punishment system. We judge people based on the worst act. And I'm here to say, in Black Lives Matter, talking about our research and talking about our punishment system, that if we are really concerned about building viable community, we've got to embrace all lives, black lives. And we've got to see that that vengeful time, that time that yet you're sitting there looking at this person that did, really, you could probably say, maybe the worst thing you would ever dream of. But that person still has value. You cannot say they don't. Because when you say they don't, you have denied the fundamental principles of humanity. You have denied, if you were a religious person, you have denied what Christ said. You have denied what Muhammad said. I'm touching all of them, right? Buddhism, all of them. You are denying the fundamental principle. So when you go back home, when you go to your neighborhoods, when you talk to your students, when you talk to your buds, and my buds, I mean men and women buds. I have men and women buds. We have to stop. We have to say no. We have to say, Black Lives Matter. I'm going to raise it. I'm going to say we need to treat people equally and not equally. I don't believe in the death penalty. I don't think it works. But I don't believe in it because I think it's consistently applied also in a very racist manner. So I can give you like 4 or 5 reasons why I don't believe in the death penalty. I'm not saying you have to agree. But the solution is the only way you're going to have a fair punishment system if we address race consciously. And if we train people consciously, if we do what some people are calling implicit bias training, if we are raising to consciousness the fact that Jesse Jackson said, and I caught myself some, so that would help me become more aware of me. How many times do we see a group of black men or boys and we cross the other side of the street? And we see a group of white boys and we keep walking because we drank the juice. We drank the juice. You can't deny we drank the juice. It ain't all about, and I'm now speaking to the black folk in this room, it ain't all about what white folk did. We drank the juice. So we have to bust it. We have to develop our own consciousness. We have to say, oops, I just judged that person based on their race or their color, Du Bois. How many times you judge based on black boy walking down the street or young man, pants down, I hate it, pants down to below their butt. But I'm gonna tell you, it's not just black boys that do that. I was on an airplane, it was an Asian family at the front of the coach. So, Asian guy got up, his pants almost down to his knees. I said, oh no, not them too. So we judge unfairly. So we've created a stereotype that says black, but it's not black. White folks steal. White folks kill. White folks do all kinds of things. And in critical race theory, part of what the Asians talk about is the model minority. They hate that because them too is a response to the critique and the stereotype of the model minority. Because they're supposed to be perfect, right? So I'm challenging you today. I'm challenging you. Young people, middle-aged people, older, because we ain't old, right? Older people. I'm challenging you to first look inside and then to have courage. Speak it. What's the worst that could happen? I'm returned. I can't get fired. I have tenure. I couldn't get fired anyway, right? But some people say, well, if I speak up, I may lose my job. If I speak up, I might not get that recommendation to go to law school. If I speak up, I may and I may and I may. And we're looking at our losses. But the lives of people are at stake. So what? Let's have courage. Because the only way we're going to bust these statistics, the only way we're going to correct the racial disparities in our punishment system, the only way we're going to really embrace Black Lives Matter is to have courage. And not just let the young folk and some crazy old folk like me raise it up. We have to have courage. We have to say, because I tell people when they start talking about black men, I'm going to sit down and take my seat a minute. When they talk about black men, I say, I don't know what you're talking about. You know, because sometimes people talk about black men and some black folk talk about black men like they got a tail. And I tell them in a minute, I don't know what you're talking about because I had a good daddy. I have good cousins. Now, I can't can't tell you every man in my family is, you know, like, has, you know, upstanding citizen, but no, neither can I tell you every woman in my family is. But we've got to have courage. We've got to speak up. And we've got to stop playing it safe and dumping lives in the gutter because we think that there is no redemption. Thank you.
Now, Dr. Aiyetoro will be receptive to respond to questions from the audience. Dr. Carolyn Blakely and Dean Ralph Owens will assist with the question and answer session.
Good morning, and I thoroughly enjoy your presentation this morning. And I am old school, and I have a question I'd like to ask. What do you mean? Would you please explain, drink the juice for me?
Oh, Lord, okay.
I'm probably the only one here that doesn't know that
answer. No, you probably aren't. If you asked it, I tell my students, if you asked it, a whole bunch of people will wonder. Drink the juice is sort of like, you know, when those folk were killed in California, they drank. No, they went to
Jim Jones. Right,
they
okay.
Drank the juice.
The juice, got you.
Right?
Okay.
So when I say drink the juice, you drank. You internalize the thoughts of white supremacy.
Right.
So it's not now just that whites are carrying it, we're all carrying it. We all are devaluing, we drank the juice, we drank the lie. We took the lie, we believed the lie. Because it was repeated over and over and over again. And much like I was saying, we have to have courage. For many of our ancestors, it was a matter of life and death, and rather than consistently saying, don't believe it, then many of them believed it and taught us.
Excuse me, I was aware of that, but I never heard that connotation of drink the juice, you know, with Jim Jones in reference to him. But you put it so succinctly, it is true. We have drunk that juice, and we have stopped teaching our children.
Some of us have.
Right. My greatest eye-opener since I retired is to go to juvenile court. And I've gone to juvenile court, and it is blackness, our young black men. And I think that's where we really need to start focusing, is in juvenile court, so that we don't get to the level that you spoke of today. I thoroughly enjoyed you, and I do have two books that I'm going to get for your presentation.
Okay.
Thank you so much, and Godspeed.
Mm-hmm. My name is Bunty Thornton, I'm senior, and one of my questions is the importance of black-owned businesses or black-oriented groups coming together to fight black issues, because I've been listening and trying to understand a lot of things, and it's, you know, kept to a conversation, and many times we always try to equate ourselves or think that we need everyone else's helping hand, but if something's going wrong in my house, I have to fix it, even though other people may be trying to help. It's still up to me and my family to do so. So I really want to know your opinion on, you know, having black people fight these issues themselves.
Well, we've always fought the issues. It's that we've always had allies, and that's what I call the whites and Latinos and Asians. Others that have been part of the movement. I want to take you back way back, because some of the biggest anti-slavery people, other than black people like Frederick Douglass and others, were white people. And so it takes everybody doing it. And I'm saying this only because I had a black student that said to me years ago in my critical theorist class, and you can imagine my response, that, you know, she really wasn't supportive of Africans because they didn't fight. They allowed us to just be taken, and they didn't fight. So I decided at that point I had to do my own research. I wasn't going to be a real professor, and some of y'all would have been. Real professors would have said, don't you go ahead and do your research. I went up to that computer, and I started pulling out stuff, and I gave it to her, and I made her write about it. So we've always fought all the way up till now, but we've always had allies. I 100% agree that we have to support. One, we have to build businesses that are black-owned, and we have to support them. I buy from black businesses anytime I can, if there's a black business that does something that I need. But I don't buy and continue to buy if you're not providing the service. So I think that that's the distinction too. But I think we should support them.
The problem we have historically has been that many of my cousin was in business, and many black companies, he was in a business that dealt with the Defense Department, right? That's racism in those things too. So we have to come together to support getting the contracts, getting the other things that are needed, but we at the bottom line, when there's a black business in our communities, we have to provide support there too. So I 100%
agree. Good morning, Dr. Aiyetoro. First of all, thank you for coming in. It was a pleasure listening to you. I wanted to know what the name of the book was that you talked about.
Just Mercy. Brian Stevenson.
Okay, thank you. And also, how do you feel about the way African Americans are educated as far as the education system goes, and what ways do you think that we can make things better so that we can help our own community?
First, I think we need to pay teachers more. I think if we pay teachers more, that does two things. It gives motivation to those who are already here working their tails off, because I can tell you, a professor that's doing his or her job is working hard, right? And I'm casually doing his or her job, right? But we have to pay them more. We have to value education in this society. We don't value it. We don't pay our teachers, especially public education and universities such as state universities, we don't pay competitive salaries. So one, it doesn't give that sense that I'm valued as a professor by the state that's employing me, right? The second thing we have to do is we have to demand excellence. We have to stop accepting inferior teaching. Different ways. Sometimes students just don't like it, so they'll give you a bad evaluation. I know that. But also sometimes student evaluations have a kernel of truth. But it is stronger if a professor stands up and says, and we all know that professors, we know that people who don't really put forth the effort, get them before they get tenured. You can't get rid of me now. But you could have gotten rid of me before I had tenure. And we have been gotten rid of on a racist basis before, right? Blacks didn't make tenure disproportionate to whites. So you have to speak up if you have a professor that you don't think is doing an adequate job. And that's not just writing some anonymous evaluation. That's having courage. That's going to the academic dean and giving examples of what's happening. But then you have to have allies among that on the same status, because they can easily dismiss the student depending on the kind of administrator it is. So if professors here know, yeah, that person comes in and they just, I know I've been in their classroom or I've talked to them and I know they're doing a real half, almost a the job, right? Then we have to speak up. We have to have courage. But I think most of all, we have to tell professors that they're valued, or teachers at the grade school level, at the college, high school level. And we have to do that, okay?
Thank you, first of all, Dr. Aiyetoro, for your speech. Right on time. And I'm on the school board, I have a school district, and I understand some of the problems that you have addressed today concerning blacks. But I think one big problem, and then I'll ask a question, is inferiority complex that we somehow have acquired along the way. And so many people won't speak up for the things that are going wrong. But one problem I have, and I want to see if you had any research concerning the laws that have been systemically put on the books that actually are deleterious toward blacks over the years. Has there been any research about how we can combat that or maybe change some of the laws that have been put on the books that specifically put more pressure on blacks?
What, give me an example.
Laws, regular crime that committed. Sometimes even the prosecutors seem to pressure blacks more to plead guilty or mm-hmm. take a plea bargain, mm-hmm. things like that. And there's been a research to address those causes instead of just the system problem.
Well, again, I've learned from the research is don't say cause, right? We do know, and we had one portion of our research that I didn't talk about was that prosecutors charge differently for blacks and whites. We did a sample of 4 counties. And what we found was, again, statistically significant, was that blacks are more likely by prosecutors to be charged with capital murder, right? And this is interesting. It was interesting to me, it was interesting to you all, that whites are less likely to be charged with aggravated robbery at the beginning, and blacks are more likely at the beginning to be charged with aggravated robbery. Well, even if whites eventually are, some people say, well, what difference? They eventually got charged with aggravated robbery. But the problem is that it affects our bail system, right? So if I get charged with aggravated robbery, I'm going to have a higher bail than someone who gets charged with just regular robbery. They're going to be out on the street, right? So the impact of that is more harsh on me because I'm locked up and most of our jails are not, busting up a theory that some of you may believe and some of you may not, that, they are not hotels. They are not nice places to be, right? And the pressure on your families and all of that, that's the thing. So that is one thing. The other thing that I think is the first part of your question or your statement, I think that we, inferiority complex is really part and parcel of the process of white supremacy. If I have said to you, a person that appears, to be dark brown skin, right? I'm a dark brown skin. But if you have been told for centuries, I'm talking about genetic memory, that you aren't good, that you aren't smart, that you are all negatives, right? And that all of that, of course, I'm surprised that more of us don't have an inferiority complex. So the issue is that is all tied to history. And some of us have been fortunate to have parents, school teachers, back to the young lady, she's gone now, question about school and educators. Some of us were fortunate to have people that kept saying, you're good as any. My mother and daddy told me I was as good as anybody else. Good as anybody else. I come home crying, so-and-so said my hair is kinky. I don't have a good hair. My mom got mad at me first, and then she had to teach me all hair is good hair. So all of that, they have studies that show little kids, they don't know anything about race. How do they learn about, how does that white child call you a nigga that you were just playing with 2 days ago? Because their parents taught them. Or somebody else. That's learned. So I think we have to continue to work on some kind of self-esteem, but I think that's another role of teachers of all races and of all genders. But first you have to start again.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Kimberly Boyd. I'm a freshman at the university. And my question is related to the Black Lives Matter movement thinking internationally, because I read that you represented in the United Nations in Beijing. How are race relations in other countries, considering that black is just a color and they didn't have the American type of slavery? So how is it in different areas?
Well, I'm sorry to disillusion you, but race or color has been a factor in all European countries. You see it in different ethnic groups in China. So it may not be based on color as much as what ethnic group you're with.
have friends in England. We used to work together in Black Law Group. And in England, they have many of the same struggles, not the exact same, but many of them very similar, being discriminated against, even, you know, because of race or color. And I keep, I'm correcting myself, because I'm a woman, right? Color. So I think because I'm here and that I've chosen to stay here, because that's a choice. You know, some of us think, well, we don't have a choice. No, you have a choice. You know, you can buy, you sell all the stuff you got, buy your one-way ticket somewhere else, right? So it's a choice. We say we don't have a choice. We have a choice. And I chose to stay here and struggle and work for racial and social ethnic and economic justice here. But there's no panacea, and color has been a problem all over. Look at what happened in France with the Algerians a number of years ago. You know, so I hope I answered your question. And I like how you speak up. I tell my students, I'm gonna take you back with me. I tell my students, speak up and speak affirmatively. I wanna hear you. Thank you for that, too.
Hello, Dr. Aiyetoro. Okay, my question is, well, I'm a criminal justice student, and before I came here, you know, I had so much faith and hope in the criminal law.
Oh.
So, basically, what would you say to a student, instructor, or a civil rights activist who wants to strive in a system that they believe less in the more they learn about it?
I don't think that you're different than many of us who have decided to become activists, social, racial, economic, whatever activists. I think that we all were taught that the law is fair, that, you know, the story, right? We were all taught the same story. Some of us had, again, I go back to family or teachers who actually taught us the real story, right? Or at least from their perspective, and we have to learn what it is for us. My view is, it's much like to that young lady that just sat down, my view is you have to choose where you stand. And you can't drop out of society. Well, you can't. Many people have dropped out of society. That's what happens with drugs, with all kinds of stuff, right? They drop out. They can't deal with it. But if you choose to be a part of the society, then you have to stand in it, and you have to stand in the reality of it. And then you have to decide, what's my work? You know, what's my work? You can't do it all. Trust me, I've tried. You can't do it all. So what's my work? And how do I bring about, or work to bring about change in what I've chosen? That's all you can do. Mm-hmm.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay. When you were talking, you spoke about the need to train judges and jurors with some type of
implicit bias training. Mm-hmm.
But I would contend that by the time that people are judges and jurors, they've lived a lifetime of, as you put it, drinking the juice, or being impacted or molded by people who drank the juice. So my question, or questions, do you think it possible, and if so, what would be some key steps to implementing training via cultural sensitivity or implicit bias training into the school teacher training or the K-12 system as a whole?
Well, I wholeheartedly agree with you. I think we have to start where, you know, from, you know, way small to way big. I agree with you. And I think that we have to address it. I think that when we are, I'm not a peer of kindergarten teachers, but when we see things in kindergarten, where we see that students are speaking out, or preschool, you know, we have to have people who are trained to say, that's not how you refer to someone, or so-and-so is as good as you, or however you do it. And I think that teachers do need implicit bias training as well, because so much of it, I won't say, I am not one to say the conscious racism is dead. I just don't think it is. I think it's maybe less so now, and I hope it is, I think it is, but I think it's still there. But I do think that many times, much like we, are unaware of the stereotypes and how we act on a stereotype. So we, as people of color, are act out a stereotype, then why shouldn't we expect that white people, I don't say non-whites and the whites, because I think that's still, come take my class in the course there. Explain that continues the white stress, right? But the point is, I do think that all of us, I was speaking mainly about judges and prosecutors because I was speaking based on the criminal punishment system. And I think that when we educate young people, young, that 4 or 5 year old, when we can say to them as teachers, if their parents aren't saying that, you know, you can't judge people based on color, no, you don't call that person a bad name because they're color or whatever, then we have to start that young, but we have to start where we are too. And I do believe that if we raise the conscious level in the criminal punishment system to police, police, judges, and prosecutors, that will have a positive effect. But your strategy will even have a bigger positive effect because we're raising it at a very, very young age.
Hi, my name is Andrea, and my question is, do you feel that blacks will ever receive reparations? Because I know personally, my great-grandmother was a slave. And from what I've been told, she never received her 40 acres of mule. So, do you think blacks will ever get that?
You must have been. I'm a reparationist, and I think we will if we build a movement, a bigger movement for it. The problem that I see as a reparationist, and I've been a reparationist since the mid-80s, is that we don't believe we deserve it. So if we don't believe we deserve it, we can't convince others that we own it. So I think we have to continue to build a movement. And I don't think it's just because your great-great-grandmother was enslaved. I don't think she was a slave, she was enslaved. Y'all had to take my secret history class. Because when we say slave, what do we think of, right? When we say enslaved, we think of something else, right? More positive. So I don't think it's just because she was enslaved. I think it's because of continuing legacy of slavery. So I would make the argument that I am due reparations, not simply because my great-grandmother and my great-grandfather were enslaved, but because of the continuing legacy of slavery. I mean, think about it. Where would I be, y'all, but for the stereotype? And the stereotype is true for women. You know, it's what Kimberly Crenshaw calls the intersectionality of race and gender. Where would we be women? Right? Another scholar, I think his name was a scholar, said Lu and Wang, said that white men are where they are in the society because of forced anti-competitiveness. Think about it. Forced anti-competitiveness. They kept men in them and they kept people of color down. So I say reparations, I know it's no doubt about it. I say we'll get it when we and our allies, because we got nothing just by us, even though we were poor many times. But when we and our allies build a big enough movement, so they have to hear us. They have to give us reparations to show them. Okay?
Mm-hmm. How are you doing?
I'm fine, how are you?
I'm great, I'm Dominic Baird, the senior at the university.
I see you support the Kansas City Royals.
It's my hometown.
All right. I cheer for you.
Yeah, I love that. But my question is, do you feel that white supremacy is going to continue to influence future generations to come, or do you think this reign will be coming to an end soon?
It comes to an end when we make it come to an end. It will influence as long as we allow it to influence. How many of you know, God is an angel, when I want you? Everybody likes it. How many of you heard it? So I was in Dallas one time and Eric Lyceum was speaking. I know him not well and I don't name drop him. I ain't saying that he's my best buddy. But he was speaking there and I was there for some some of those. In fact, I was there for a reparations activity. And after it was over, we went to where he was speaking, and the topic was affirmative action, and that was part of the theme of what it was. And somebody said, well, how long should black people get affirmative action? He said, for as long as white men had affirmative action, 500 years. So I'm saying that to say that we have to speak and act in a way that says that's no longer the case. You may be reaping the benefits because they are. Why do we still see white men leading most corporations? In fact, overwhelmingly so. Why do we see white men in the leadership of all over the country? Look at our judges. I mean, they're screaming and hollering about one another, Antonin Scalia. Right? Look who's on the bench. We've got one black Supreme Court justice who, of course, I don't think has our best interests at heart. That's me. So one. Look at our judges across the state. How many are black? How many prosecutors? We used to have one black prosecutor out of Texarkana. Now he's a judge. How many are women? How many are black women? How many are women of color? How many are men of color? Not just black. So we have to say no. And we have to campaign when in Arkansas, judges are elected. How many of you vote and encourage competence? See, I don't believe in putting forward somebody just because they got a black face or face color. That does us harm. That does us harm. But how many of you are supporting and encouraging people of color to step up, to want, and then support them? Because it takes support. So I think that the end to white supremacy is, I think it's dying, but it's a very slow death. It's going to die faster if all of us, black, white, Asian, Latino, all of us say no. President Johnson said, no, I promise I'm going to shut up after this.
It's okay.
President Johnson said, you know, y'all talk all day long about President Johnson being, he's waiting for your time, honey. But being from Texas, but do you know that guy had more wherewithal and support racial equality than a whole bunch of us, including those who let me ride and who lift up President Kennedy, who hesitated to deal with the race violence in the South. I'm gonna hit on now because I don't get ready. Hit somebody all up. President Clinton,
yes,
who left the trail, the campaign trail, to come and sign a death warrant for a black retarded man. Two black men, but one was black and retarded. He had any number of reasons he didn't have to do that.
That's right.
Who ended welfare? Who do you think that impacted the most? Right! So we talk all day long because he plays the sax. Because he, you know, from some of y'all, because he's from Arkansas. Because he says he likes black folk. But do you know how many times he spoke for us as opposed to letting us speak for ourselves? So I'm saying we have to lift it. We have to stop supporting people based on some shallow image. Johnson said, that's what I was starting to say, I can't get sidetracked. Johnson said, he believed in affirmative action. Why? Johnson said that if you have a race, and we start off the race, and he was talking about white man. This is that white man from Texas.
Yeah.
He said, if you start a race, and you now say, everything's equal, right? Everything's fair. But you got white men here, and black and white women about here, and black men about here, or black women, I can't remember, at some point, black women, I think, here, and then black men here, and then you shoot the gun. How many of you are stop embracing theories that are to our disadvantage?
Because we think it's a student.
Right? And we also have to stop embracing people because of some coolness that they present. Playing sax. Hood Latin. You got black folks, Bernice. I never remember that woman's name. She was a congresswoman from Texas who started calling him the first black president. Every last black person should have been insulted.
That's right.
Insulted. So I was a long answer to your very good question.
I enjoyed it.
Ms. Angel Thurman, who is a member of the Lyceum Committee, will now acknowledge and recognize some very important people and events.
The Lyceum Committee would like to draw your attention to the special acknowledgement section on the program. Because without the help of those very important people, the Lyceum program and many other related activities would not have been possible. We would also like to recognize Ms. Tisha Arnold, who left early, but she has been a huge help to the Lyceum Committee when it came to public relations and communication support. Please join me in thanking everyone. Next, would all community leaders and members of the Chancellor Cabinet please stand as we clap to show our appreciation for your presence. Thank you. We will also appreciate everyone who participated on today's program, as well as our host and hostess from the Carolyn F. Blakely Honors College, to please stand as we thank you. Finally, would the members of the 2016 Lyceum Committee please stand as we show our appreciation. As it was mentioned earlier, I was one of the students on the Lyceum Committee who wanted to bring the Black Lives Matter movement to the attention of the campus. I really do appreciate Dr. Aiyetoro and her presentation for really bringing the truth about Black Lives Matter, just not those who are on television. For example, Trayvon Martin, Michael Brown, Freddie Gray, all of our lives do matter, not only those who have been shot down by policemen or shot down by other individuals. Not only those who make the media matter. We all matter, and we should all take heed to what Dr. Aiyetoro said today and stop drinking the juice. We should stop being stereotypical towards ourselves, and we should really uplift and promote one another. So I hope everything she said today will be something that we'll take back to our classrooms and explain to our students when the next time we see another student in the media who might have been shot down by a black person or a white person. Either way, it's wrong, and all lives do matter. And with that being said, I would like Dr. McCray and Dr. Aiyetoro to please join me at the podium. On behalf of Dr. Lawrence B. Alexander and Dr. McCray, please accept this gift presented to you by students, faculty, and staff at the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff.
This has been a marvelous program. We have many programs and speakers on our campus very frequently, but this one truly is in a class by itself. I can see the faces of the audience, the students, the faculty, the community leaders. Dr. Aiyetoro, you done good. Excuse me, Dr. Lorenz. I just couldn't resist that. And I don't know that there's anything else that I can say. It's been a wonderful program. Dr. Aiyetoro was a marvelous speaker. She challenged our minds. She opened our hearts. She gave us inspiration for the future. She told us what role we need to play in our communities. She just did everything. And so I'm going to do one last thing. I'm going to say a quote that my minister said. One Sunday we had a guest speaker. and the speaker didn't do so well. And when he got up, he said, "What can you say about a sermon like that?" Well, I tell you what, we can say plenty about the sermon that we just heard. Thank you so much, Dr. Aiyetoro, and thank you, audience, for coming.